Good afternoon. We're live from Bali at the World Bank annual meetings, and this is the Facebook Live series Global Voices. I'm Sophie Edwards, a reporter with DevEx, and I'm joined by Philippe Le Houérou, the CEO of the IFC. So it's great to be here. So I wanted to talk today, Philippe, about a new policy that you announced on Monday to do with IFC lending for financial intermediaries and trying to move away less exposure in coal. So tell us about the policy and how it came about.
Well, first of all, it's good to see you again, Sophie, and talk to DevEx. I mean, if you remember, it goes back about a year and a half ago, where there was a lot of questioning about IFC investing through financial institution to get to SME, for example, because it's very hard for IFC to kind of have small loans. So we needed to work through the financial institution. So the question came that if this is the case, why do you have kind of general line of credits? And that we started with that. We said that good point. All our lending now is targeted. So we have different programs. One is small scale enterprise, which I feel very strongly about because 90% of employment is through small and middle sized enterprise, as you know. But also women, we have a big agenda, but it's kind of financing for women entrepreneur. So that's another type of line of credit. We have line of credit for climate, by the way, greening a company, etc. So we have, the idea is to get only targeted line of credit as opposed to general, because okay. They say if it is general, then you have to take responsibility for everything that this financial institution is doing.
Yeah.
So that's on the lending we solved by saying it's all targeted now. Then the question comes, okay, and that's 95% of everything we do with financial institution is
ring-fenced.
Exactly, targeted. The remaining 5% is either operation like swaps, stuff like that, purely financial engineering, or equity, because we take equity stocks in some of the banks. Now, when you take the stock, then that was the discussion. Then, are you responsible for everything? If you have a 1% of the capital, are you accountable with everything that the bank does?
And this is where the coal financing.
That's where the coal financing. Mm-hmm. So, well, if the bank does even 0.01% of coal financing in the portfolio, are you accountable? And there was this back and forth, and IFC, I think the position was, we cannot be accountable for everything. We have our ENS, and by being at the board, we enforce our environment, social, and governance standards, which are pretty tough and much tougher than what we see in our client countries. Mm. So we thought it was a good thing anyway, which is true. Now, what we did, and that's very recent, I challenged the team to say, okay, well, we need to answer to this question, I mean, and we need to be clear. And we decided, I mean, I can spare you the details, a lot of back and forth, but in the end, you say, okay, if you believe that climate change is really the issue of the day, of our generation, I think that we have to be to try something different. So the idea was, and it's half, we need to cook it more, but the direction is to say, okay, why don't, instead of not doing equity, because then I can kind of get rid of the problem, but do equity, and do equity in banks that have a portfolio in coal, but under the understanding that we will work with this bank to green the portfolio over time, it's not, and then get rid of coal. The alternative will be to invest only in banks that have no coal, but then you're not changing much. What I like is, I think IFC role is to change. And to change means getting rid of coal portfolio. Why? In the big scheme of things, we're not that big, but we have, I think, a good name to send a signaling of the direction we want to go. So I think we need in the next few months and that we call that the green green equity strategy, but we need to flesh it out.
Okay.
So I have to be honest, it's not fleshed out on the detail, how we will do it, over what period of time do we say, how do we engage, what does it mean, how much, so. But the direction is taken, and now we're gonna, in the next few months, work on the details. But the idea is very simply, let's invest in banks in emerging markets that have a portfolio and operations in coal with the objective to get rid of them.
Okay.
That's the idea.
Terrific. And I, from what I understand, civil society groups have been have welcomed the move, and I think it's a good signal, especially you know, to other banks and other DFIs as well. But one of the questions is, why stop at just coal? What about other fossil fuel related activities like oil and gas?
Well, I guess the answer may not be satisfactory, but I think that we have to be pragmatic and start with the worst offender, which is coal. So let's do that. There's a lot of it in the world, again. So let's start with that and let's see. Let's take it from there. So maybe we'll go to fuel and, but because we need also, I mean, the thing that for me is very important is I do believe that IFC is really a force for good, but we're small. If you look at the balance sheet, I mean, we had the record year last year with mobilization is $23 billion. It's very little. So if you want to be a leader, you have to be ahead of the game, but not so far as nobody follows you, because then you're all alone.
Yeah.
And the impact is really minimal. So it's always, there's not a science. You have to feel that. How far can you go with people will follow? And if you go too far, too fast, people will say, okay, well.
Yeah.
So for me, that's impact means leveraging and being followed by others. So we are ahead of the game, but if you go too far ahead, then a lot of other institutions will say this is not realistic. Because it's true that today, I mean, you know, coal and fuel and gas are the backbone of energy, and you cannot have development without energy. So we need to pace ourselves, test it with coal, which is the worst offender. I think that shifting from coal to gas would be a big plus, by the way, for example. So let's do it, and then we'll see. I mean, we're not in the world of static. It's all or nothing, now or never. And
yeah.
So let's move.
Okay.
And whatever we do, there will be critics from all sides.
Yeah.
And that's okay. But at the end, you have to think that you're doing the right thing at the right time. And when you read the new IPCC report that was just released at the UN, I mean, that comforts me that we're doing the right thing. This is time is now.
It's urgent, yeah.
And to be bold is not a luxury.
Okay.
That's my real belief. But again, with the little bemol that I want to be followed, because we're too small. And to be followed, that's leadership.
Yeah.
Leadership without being followed is being a singleton. So that's what we're trying to find, what is the frontier where we can do some good and be followed so that we multiply the impact we can have.
And sticking on that topic of leadership, I understand that another thing that IFC is coming out with this week is some new draft impact investment principles.
Yes.
I think that's on Friday is the launch. Maybe you could tell us a little bit about what those principles are and what you're hoping to achieve with them.
Well, the idea, I mean, as you know, 2 years ago, we launched our own impact, development impact measurements in IFC, where we have for every aim, for every project, we have a number where we measure ex ante the development impact of every project. And then we follow through during and after. So that's why it's ex ante, but it's also the monitoring part is during the project and when the project closes. And we did a lot of work. So I think that gave us a lot of insights on how can we measure impact now. So that's one stream. The other stream is we are seeing now more and more, it's very small. The industry is very kind of starting.
The impact investment industry
is about $35 billion a year, which is very little.
Yeah.
in the big scheme of things, frankly, it's very little. But this is the time to kind of put principle around what does it mean, impact investing? Because you talk to different people, they will come up with different response, which is not very good, because you don't want impact washing. Like we did with the green bond, we put some principle around the green bond. Otherwise, you have greenwashing.
Yeah.
So, and IFC, the World Bank, EBRD, worked in London with the International Capital Association with this principle on green. What is green?
Right.
We want to do the same for impact.
So that's sort of to stop anything being labeled as impact
investing. Correct. Okay. So we'll disclose. I don't want to disclose now because it's Friday.
Oh, okay.
So we have an embargo, but it's pretty straightforward. Yeah. It's basically more about the process at this stage. It's nine principles. But we will open the discussion. We don't want to close the discussion.
Yeah.
I think that, again, to be followed, you have to have people that are ready to follow you.
Yeah.
So we want people under the tent. We're launching it this time, and in 6 months during the spring meeting, then we'll have a signing, bringing people on board and signing on the principles. But between now and then, we'll do a lot of work to validate those principles.
Okay.
In fact, we want to print a report that we call the flagship, that will give some intellectual basis for this principle. So it's exciting. We hope it will lead to a more formal launch in 6 months. Not a launch, but an agreement. I need to bring the industry.
Yeah, so first question, what makes you think, what is it about ISC which makes you able to sort of take this role?
That's a good question.
Who are you hoping to influence with these principles?
Very good question. We want to influence the private sector, private funds.
Okay.
So why us? Because we are multilateral. So that gives us a public good aspect. Because if you go to a fund, particular fund, you don't want them to say, well, the impact is what I do.
Right.
So, I mean, that's the beauty of multilateral, that you basically have some credibility because of the design of the multilateral institution. So that's one. And second, frankly, if you think about our article of agreement, since 1956, we have the mother of all impact investors. By design, we're pushed to do the toughest thing with the private sector in emerging markets.
Okay, so you see yourself as one of the early impact investors?
Without, we didn't have the name at the time.
Right.
And of the work that we have done, very serious work that we have done the last 2 years with this quantification. So we're not proposing for everybody to quantify the way we do it, but we have learned, and I think we can share some of these principles. But again, we don't want to close the door, we want to open the tent. And not only to impact investors, but also to CSOs, civil society, academics. I mean, you know, there's, again, this is the beginning of an adventure. It's time to be open, to decide on the principle and move forward. And obviously the hope is that there's all kind of estimate on how much assets are under management. They talk about 100 trillion, that's IMF figure of a few years ago.
Uh-huh.
Some say 200 trillion, whatever it is, let's assume you take 1% that go for impact. This is huge, potentially, but today is very small.
Mm-hmm.
So again, like the green bond that didn't exist 10 years ago, now it's 150 billion, the green bond market, and growing very fast.
Yeah.
Well, maybe we'll have the same growth for impact investing. And again, it can be private equity, it can be investing in stocks, on the public stocks, it can be in lending, project finance, it can be different type of assets.
Yeah.
But before you get the qualifier of impact, we need to have some agreement of what does it mean.
Right.
And how you monitor, how you validate.
Yes.
Like the green bond. For me, the green bond is a good parallel.
And are you working with other DFIs on this too?
Yes. We're working with everybody. Again, the tent is open.
Yeah.
We brought everybody under the tent. Some are more active than others, which is normal. And we're going to continue the next 6 months very, very hard. So this is a launch to make sure that we heard.
Yeah.
Bring people under the tent.
Uh-huh.
And then hopefully in 6 months you'll see the white smoke. Habemus Papam and Habemus Impact.
The white smoke.
Habemus impact investment principles.
Okay.
But it's a hope. But we believe it's true, and there is, again, the millennials are starting to change the equations. And that's why you see more and more kind of private equity funds, for example, qualifying their investment as impact. Why? Because they know that's what their client, the investor, is asking.
Yeah.
And the new generation, I think the pure returns is not good enough.
Right.
They will want returns, but also, I don't know, we talk about climate change, pro-climate, for example. But that's an impact. Or pro-health. Or pro a poor country. I mean, it can be sliced in different part, but we believe that the new generation is going to ask for more than just financial returns.
Right.
They want financial returns and some kind of positive impact for society.
Yeah. Do you see financial return, even a small one though, as being integral to a definition of impact investing? Or can you have
both
zero financial impact and still be an impact investor?
Well, you can, but that's more like social. But that part exists already, but it's very tiny, it's very small. The beauty about trying to get also to the financial returns is that opens up a huge amount of assets under investment.
Mm.
And the unit becomes a trillion of dollars.
Yeah.
As I said, 100 trillion. I mean, this is not kind of responsible investing, which is a slice of it. No, we want to have the big market. So the returns have to be there. And frankly, I mean, I have no problem. That's why I think IFC is a very interesting place, because you want to make the demonstration that doing good doesn't mean losing money. And that's the basis of sustainability financially.
Right.
I mean, if you do good but you lose money all the time, you're not going to do it for too long. I mean,
right.
I'm sorry, but it's true.
Yeah.
And the point is, we believe in IFC that you can actually have a return, not extraordinary, but a decent return, and actually be transformative.
And without having trade-offs and negative incentives.
Exactly. We believe it.
Okay. And your principles will tell us how to do that?
They will give those that are interested to have a minimum set of principles to follow to demonstrate that actually doing impact, that there is a delta, that is just not buying a stock and waiting the returns.
Yeah.
You have to follow the impact, which means, like the green bond, being able to demonstrate what you have done with the proceeds.
Yeah.
If you say, I want to do, health here in Bali, then you have to demonstrate, okay, what is your thesis? What do you want to do? And then monitor it to show if you have had one, the financial result, but also the health results. I'm just taking an example like that.
Okay.
But that's the point.
Yeah.
And we believe that the market is there.
Uh-huh. And this will be the way to unlock billions and trillions.
Listen, I mean, we have been since 2015, the UN called this very nice conference in Addis Ababa, the billions to trillions.
Yeah.
What does it mean? It means bringing money towards development and de facto impact. But it has to be with a return, otherwise it's not going to come. And it's going to be marginal. So if you want to be transformative, we have to find a way to marry the two.
Yeah.
And I think maybe I'm too optimistic, but I think it's happening.
Yeah.
And it's going to happen more and more. Mm-hmm. And for me, the green bond market is a fantastic story. It didn't exist in 2007, zero.
Yeah.
Now it's 150 billion. And in the next 2 years, my staff tell me it can be 300 billion.
Yeah.
So it's huge.
Yeah.
And that was a creation from the multilateral development banks. Huh?
Yeah.
Now it goes much beyond us. But I believe that we can do the same for impact.
Brilliant. And a final question, Philippe. Obviously, the IFC seems to have a growing prominence and a growing role within the World Bank Group. You secured a capital increase of 5.5 billion at the last meetings. Congratulations on that.
Thank you.
How do you sort of see yourself and the role at IFC, and you've been there for about 2 years now? How do you sort of see that evolving and shaping?
I believe that IFC can be one of the instruments to transform this billion to trillion from an idea, a concept, into reality. We are, in my view, the best position MDB to do it and to show the way. So that's my ambition, and the cascade idea, which means let's try, instead of running straight for a public solution, let's try the private first. Regulated, not anything goes, but let's try that, and that for infrastructure. I was at the conference earlier today on Indonesia, where the needs are huge in infrastructure. Yeah. There's no way the public can deal with it, the public purse. So you have to crowd in private finance.
Yeah.
And that's what we are trying to do. And not only that, same for SME, we can do the same even in health and education, which is contentious. I want to reopen the door. Now we're launching during this meeting the Human Capital Index, which I think is a very good idea.
Tomorrow, yeah.
But then the question is going to come very quickly. So how do you improve both the volume, but also the quality of education and health? Well, very quickly, you run into the same issue of funds. Is the public finance will be able to do it or not?
Yeah.
And then we'd have to be imaginative and find new, more creative public-private solution, which at the end of the day, I think we're going into a world where capitalism is becoming more responsible. The private sector is becoming more responsible. And in many countries, the government are seeing the potential of working with the private sector. That's my view, that's what I see more and more. And I think that IFC can show, it's going to be trial and error.
But
I am very confident.
And since you mentioned it, PPPs and education
is
a very controversial
topic.
Can you give us a few words on your position on that?
Listen, I grew up in Africa and I saw very bad public services in health and education.
In Ethiopia,
in Madagascar, and in Mali, many, many countries. The point is, I think that the old recipe, repeating the same recipe and expecting a better outcome, is weird. Same cause, same consequences. So I think that we owe it to the kids, the next generation, to try new things. But have the courage, if it doesn't work, to pull the plug. And we're trying, but we like to be evidence-based. We try with Bridge, for example, where we have been criticized. Yeah. But let's see what are the results. And we are, in fact, bringing on board a very famous economist to do an evaluation, deep evaluation of this particular experiment. Okay. But I do believe that experimenting is not a bad thing. It's good. It's a good thing.
Who's the economist?
It's from some, I don't have the name, but some professor in Harvard University.
Okay, we can put up.
Yeah.
Lance Pritchard, maybe. Please.
No. Someone else.
Okay.
The main point is we're trying to assess what is true, what is not true.
Yeah.
And it has to be evidence, because otherwise it's a matter of credo. I believe that.
Right.
I believe this.
Ideology
kicks in 2 minutes and you don't move. So I believe in trial and error. It may be less clean, but it may be more impactful.
Okay.
So close the loop with impact.
Okay, close the loop with impact. Perfect. Thank you so much, Philippe.
thank
you very much for tuning in to this Facebook Live series at the Bali meetings. Thanks a lot.
Thank you. Maybe in 6 months.
Yeah, another one in 6 months. So,
I'll give you the principles.